Gates is a complicated person.
Bill Gates at Microsoft was this cold-hearted bully, whereas Bill Gates at the Gates Foundation is widely celebrated because of billions of dollars he's given away. But it's not the innocent humanitarian organization that we've been led to believe it is.
It was really scandalous. Country after country, absolute horror scenes of bodies piling up. Something went seriously wrong with COVID vaccine production.
He has more power than entire countries. Competitors were afraid of Gates' endless resources to destroy them.
Speaking out against Bill Gates, it could have repercussions.
But I just decided it was time to talk about the person he really is.
Insiders have never been brave enough to speak publicly. Until now.
I have a PhD in mathematics. I am the recipient of 21 honorary doctorates, and I was chosen by Fortune to be number 17 on their list of the 50 greatest leaders in the world. My daughter, she says, "Mom, you beat Angelina Jolie." And I said, "But I lost out to the Dalai Lama."
My name is Maria Clave. I'm a computer scientist, and I served on the Microsoft board from 2009 to 2015. I didn't really know Bill Gates before I joined the Microsoft board, and I really thought of him as yes, being a champion for helping people in the world that needed help.
Are we going to ask you to support another campaign about empowering women and girls? Absolutely.
Because if everyone in the world thought of themselves as global citizens, it would help make sure that women and girls receive the education, opportunity, and respect they deserve.
Only global citizens can make global change.
If we can all think of ourselves as global citizens, girls and women will be supported throughout the world.
What do you make of him saying that?
He's a jerk. The work that the Gates Foundation has done, it's supporting poor women in Africa and in many other parts of the world. It's obvious to me that that's not a priority for him. But he's willing to be videotaped, saying it's a priority for him. I went up to Bill at a board meeting and said, "I'm thinking about diversity in STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics." And he just said straight out, "I'm not interested in diversity."
Maria Clave has never before spoken out about Gates' attitudes to diversity.
This is someone who has set out to achieve things that are clearly at odds with his personal beliefs.
Bill Gates has spent decades devoted to philanthropy. He's pledged over $100 billion of his own money, made through commercial ventures, and as founder of software giant Microsoft. Raised in Seattle, he was born into privilege.
He lived in a very nice neighborhood. His father, head of a large legal firm, they had plenty of wealth. And Bill learned from the best schools in the country.
I met Bill Gates in high school. He was quite nerdy, quite opinionated. I don't think he was very popular. I don't recall him having a girlfriend in high school, but I could be wrong. Being friends with Bill Gates had a lot to do with computers. There were 10 of us that were really nerdy. So there was Bill Gates, Paul Allen, me. We were all self-taught.
Gates used his technical gifts to advance his high school status, as he playfully acknowledged as an older man who'd become the toast of showbiz.
You were so far ahead of people in your high school class with knowledge of computers that the school hired you, didn't they?
That's right. I did the school scheduling. It was a very nice position to be in.
And how did you make that work to your advantage?
Well, we had 80% boys and 20% girls.
Right.
But in my classes, they were all girls.
Just you, because you worked the schedule into the... There you go.
Gates later dropped out of Harvard University to achieve his dream of building a software company, along with his school friend Paul Allen.
Microsoft grew at an incredible pace. Anything that was an important problem to be solved using computers, he wanted to have Microsoft software available to solve it with, and not just in the US, but worldwide.
Every article about you always mentions you drive your car too fast, and you kind of live a very fast life, lots of hours, stay up late, used to stay up all nighters and that kind of thing. It's almost like a high-tech, like Fonzie character.
I like coming in and seeing, you know, I've got a full day of things to do, and I like, taking planes that fly all night because then I don't waste a lot of time.
Within just a few years, Gates and Allen had built Microsoft into a $1 billion-a-year company.
Bill, he was very proud of his technical ability, and he could be very intimidating, because he had recall of a lot of information. Bill could be frightening if you let him.
He'd attack you, he'd belittle you, he'd really go at you. The phrase later in Microsoft, you'd always say, that's the stupidest thing I've ever seen. You'd be working on something fairly complicated. Bill would decide it's simple. And he'd come at you, saying, why isn't this done? It'd be very much in your face.
Gates's behavior became public after a film crew was allowed into Microsoft for the first time.
That's ridiculous. I'm not using this thing.
No. Somebody's confused. Somebody's just not thinking.
I mean, there's no way.
We'll figure it out.
You guys never understood. You never understood the first thing about this.
That clip is part of probably a typical Bill G review, because probably before that, he asked a question and he didn't like their answer, and that sets him off.
Gates also developed a reputation for ruthlessness. Even Paul Allen, Gates' lifelong friend and business partner, wasn't spared.
The fallout between Paul and Bill, I was right there. That was right before I left. Paul was sick at that time.
This revealing news report was able to capture the emotional fallout for Paul Allen.
Allen was miserable and felt he was being marginalized. And then things got a lot worse. He got cancer. One night he passed by Gates's office and overheard him talking with Steve Ballmer, who'd been hired to help run the company.
What were they saying?
They were basically talking about how they were planning to dilute my share down to almost nothing. And it was really a shocking and disheartening moment for me.
You were sick.
Well, I think I was still probably in the middle of radiation therapy.
Bill was complaining that he wasn't making enough effort. There can be a tendency with Bill, what have you done for me lately? No matter how much you've done before, what only counts is what you've done for me lately.
He was arrogant and barbaric. Bill Gates believed in a world of win or lose. He believed, if I win, you have to lose. And as a younger man, he was a killer.
Hello. I'm Bill Gates, chairman of Microsoft. In this video, you're going to see the future, Windows.
He was all geek Microsoft, and the public face of cheesy Microsoft adverts with the help of a catchy tune and some amateur rap.
We're introducing something new. It's essential for all, the many and the few.
It's in your store, ooh, Microsoft, that's who.
By the early 90s, Bill Gates had turned Microsoft into a giant. The man who transformed the software industry also found love, becoming engaged to Melinda French, a computer scientist at Microsoft.
I think Bill and Melinda ended up together because they complemented each other a great deal. They could talk business. She is a very smart lady.
The happy couple, seen joyfully cutting their wedding cake, would form a powerful partnership. The pair captured the public imagination, leading to fawning profile pieces like this.
They always looked like they had a very special thing going, you know, a level of intimacy and a level of intellectual connection that just caused sparks.
39-year-old Bill Gates had settled into a new life as a married man. It seemed that Bill Gates now truly had it all.
Bill Gates was now the richest man in the world from selling 100 million copies of the Windows operating system. But he saw emerging companies like Netscape as a threat to his empire.
The competition was so intense, all these new upstarts coming in, it increased the sense of dog-eat-dog, winner-take-all world.
Bill Gates' reputation certainly was as a ruthless competitor. You never wanted to go against the behemoth because they would crush you.
Bill Gates was seen by his peers and in the industry as an entitled, arrogant geek. No matter how successful he was, he could not bear to see someone else doing something better than him. I was tipped off. I was sent to Las Vegas to this big computer conference. I was interviewing a senior executive in the industry who didn't want to be seen talking to a member of the press. So he asked me to meet with him in the parking lot, off the record, and said to me, "You should look into the Federal Trade Commission's secret investigation of Gates and Microsoft and all the illegal practices they're using to tie up the entire industry." The feds were on Gates' tail for lots of illegal practices and market manipulation, leveraging market power, and so forth. And it snowballed into this enormous story with lots of people who are so afraid of saying anything bad about Gates that they still won't go on the record about it.
What are people afraid of?
People are afraid of Gates' power and endless resources to destroy them.
It turned out that Gates had been threatening companies who used Netscape instead of Microsoft's Internet Explorer.
If you were a computer manufacturer, you had to take his operating system, and it's going to coerce you to drop the Netscape browser and take our free browser, Internet Explorer, instead. He was out to kill anyone who didn't cooperate with him.
His critics in the press were also brought to heel.
He was seen as a draconian leader and someone who would try to make sure that he controlled the media narrative surrounding his business practices.
I was writing for many newspapers and magazines. By the time the book came out, it got so much attention. Gates was obsessively stating my name all over the world to journalists and editors who then called me and saying, "He's obsessed that you have inside information. He's telling everyone never publish a word that Wendy Goldman Rome writes." I started feeling, is this worth it?
Wendy Goldman Rome claims she was then targeted by anonymous supporters of Gates.
I would get threatening phone calls and a voice on the other lines whispering,
Wendy, we're going to get you.
And then hanging up. I remember being very paranoid. Everything I was doing was being watched. And wondering, was I being followed? And then someone in the industry suggested I have my phone line swept for bugs, and I did. And they were bugged. Of course, you can't prove who did it, right? I have never been so stressed in my life.
After 8 years investigating Bill Gates and Microsoft's monopolistic behavior, the US government finally took action. Microsoft was charged with engaging in anti-competitive practices.
It wasn't O.J. Simpson, but it was close. It was astonishing. It was the most carefully watched technology trial of the century.
The main attraction was Gates's evidence, given in a 3-day-long deposition when questioned by star prosecutor David Boies.
This is a message from you, and you type in here, importance colon high.
No.
No?
No, I didn't type that.
Who typed in high?
A computer.
A computer.
Bill Gates went into the deposition incredibly annoyed with the whole process. He thought that the government had no right to go after him. And then I don't think he, you know, had much respect for people within the process.
It's weird that you're repeating this exhibit without the disclosures to the email.
Without
it's very
what?
Misleading to have the version of the document. You had the real exhibit earlier. Did you lose it? I can explain
first,
what you're confused about.
I'm not confused, Mr. Gates.
To see him in this, you know, really ugly context, behaving in a really childish-like way, like, shocked a lot of people. They're like, wow, how can you be so smart and so stupid at the same time?
The judge took a dim view of Gates's disastrous deposition, and after a bruising trial, his reputation was in tatters.
I'm pleased to say that the court unanimously found that Microsoft engaged in unlawful conduct to maintain its dominant position in the computer operating systems.
Bill Gates took it badly, actually, and very personally, and was not doing well. Felt like he'd been wrongfully attacked, or, you know, that the whole world was against him.
Oh, they have the internet on computers now.
Homer, Bill Gates is here.
Around the time of the antitrust trial, it would make sense that the Simpsons would portray Bill Gates as a shark.
Buy him out, boys.
It just suggests how unpopular he was at that period of time, and how his behavior was held up for ridicule.
Hey, what the hell's going on?
Oh, I didn't get rich by writing a lot of checks.
It's not like he's a tobacco executive who has been shown to be trying to kill people. No, he's trying to sell more Windows operating systems.
Gates was in need of an image change. He stepped down as Microsoft CEO in 2000 to start a significant new chapter as a philanthropist.
I had a chance to help with the vaccination of several of the children, and it was very gratifying to see.
Through the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, he spent billions funding vaccines and fighting everything from poverty to climate change.
Some said you could say he buys his way out of the reputation of this evil genius tech guy. And thank God he did. I mean, how many people are alive because he did? When you go around and see people in Africa who are starving or don't have access to clean water, and you think about how to solve that problem, become a bigger person.
I don't think it's me that's humanized him, but I don't think that you can be out in the developing world and not be touched by what you've seen. And Bill travels extensively. We travel together and alone to the developing world, and I think you come back changed and touched by that, and I think that's part of what you're seeing.
With $65 billion spent since he launched the foundation, everyone now wanted a piece of Bill Gates.
There does seem to be this idea of Bill Gates at Microsoft was this cold-hearted, cunning, calculating, brash bully, whereas Bill Gates at the Gates Foundation is generous, he's kind-hearted, he's warm-hearted, he's a humanitarian. But I think it's important to understand that the Gates Foundation isn't an innocent check-writing charity.
Bill Gates is a complicated person.
And Mr. Gates?
I think with the Gates Foundation, Bill very deliberately wanted to fix his terrible reputation. It was definitely a very successful move in terms of changing how people saw him. However, I'm absolutely certain that the person in the 90s is the same person that Bill Gates is today.
While Gates led the foundation, he remained at Microsoft as chairman until 2014. Maria Clave is speaking on camera about his behavior for the first time.
I remember walking into my first board meeting. There were about 10 people around the table. There were only two women. There was a presentation on the succession for the people who might succeed the CEO. There were 50 people on the list. They were all male. When I commented that there were no women on the list and there were only two people of color in there, that's when he yelled at me, "Are you trying to fucking destroy this company?" And I was like, "You what? Did that really happen?" What he meant by that was it was so obvious that there were no women who might be capable of doing something like that, and that anyone who thought that a woman could play a leadership role was clearly an idiot. Why would I even ask the question? He thought it was particularly appropriate to denigrate me in front of everybody else. It makes me feel like my experiences with Bill Gates as somebody who was very dismissive towards women, that that's just simply who he is.
Under Gates's chairmanship, just 17% of Microsoft's workforce were women.
There's the person he projects as the leader he wants to be seen as, helping make the world a better place. And then in his day-to-day interactions, he treats women without respect. He's living a double life.
Gates has been leading a double life for decades. The 80s and 90s saw allegations of womanizing, weekends away with a former girlfriend, and pool parties with strippers.
He had his favorite women who he sometimes would bring to meetings with him, especially when he was traveling abroad. This goes on in business all the time and with the most powerful men since time immemorial. It's well documented in the press. He appreciates beautiful young women.
Gates's conflicted attitude to women came to the fore in 2019, when his relationship to a notorious pedophile was revealed.
Bill Gates began meeting with Jeffrey Epstein in 2011, which was years after his sex offense conviction. I think a reasonable person would see that it would be a liability for Bill Gates to consort with somebody like that. But he chose to do so.
His relationship with Epstein also led to Melinda Gates filing for divorce. She shocked the world by doing this tell-all interview, making clear her reasons.
It was many things, but I did not like that he'd had meetings with Jeffrey Epstein, no. Mm-hmm. I made that clear to him. I also met Jeffrey Epstein exactly one time.
Did you?
He was abhorrent. He was evil personified. I had nightmares about it afterwards.
I thought it was an incredibly revealing and surprising interview. She didn't shy away from answering questions.
Allegations surfaced that Gates had had affairs with employees at Microsoft.
Bill, we have so much to catch up on. It's good to see you. Good morning.
Good to see you.
Well, I think this is the...
But he glossed over the details in a soft media interview designed to promote his book about COVID.
Were you unfaithful in your marriage?
Yes. I caused pain, and I feel terrible about that. I don't think delving into the particulars at this point is constructive.
Gates was also given a platform to be seemingly contrite about his relationship with Epstein.
I certainly made a huge mistake. I didn't realize that in a meeting with him, almost downplayed the incredibly awful things he did.
Despite the divorce and ensuing scandal, Bill and Melinda Gates continue to run their foundation together.
What was stunning to me is that the news media took such a vigorous look at the misconduct allegations and the relationship with Epstein. But we also need to get to a place where journalists scrutinized the Gates Foundation, which is not the innocent humanitarian organization that we've been led to believe it is. Almost all of the Gates Foundation's work is directed at poor Black and brown people. But most of the money it gives out, it doesn't go to Africa, as the marketing message would suggest, is going to organizations in wealthy nations, United States, United Kingdom, Switzerland.
Nearly 90% of Gates's funding goes to Western institutions like Oxford and Harvard, who work on international development, and to corporations like MasterCard.
The Gates Foundation is giving money to large pharmaceutical companies like Pfizer and GSK and Merck. Any fancy institution anywhere in the world are probably getting funding for the Gates Foundation, and that's part and parcel of how it builds its network of power by creating financial links to powerful, influential institutions.
I mean, money talks. He has more power than entire countries. But he doesn't have journalists going after him because he funds so many of them.
Bill Gates has given over $300 million to some of the world's leading newspapers and broadcasters to cover health and development issues.
When the Gates Foundation gives money to a newsroom, it doesn't simply cut them a check. They're trying to buy influence over the news reporters.
One area that has, until now, been underreported is Gates' financial affairs.
Bill Gates is definitely giving away money, but he's not as generous as people think. About 50 cents of every dollar he donates to the foundation would otherwise go to taxes. So Bill Gates gets a real public benefit running this foundation in terms of billions of dollars in tax subsidies.
Much of the Gates Foundation's money is generated through little-known commercial investments, seemingly at odds with its charitable aims.
Bill Gates is the largest private farmland owner in the United States. He owned a massive farm that just produces acres of potatoes, which produce McDonald's French fries. The Gates Foundation has had investments in tobacco, in arms manufacturers, in fast food, in private prisons. It's all a dollar and cents arguments. It's about making money.
You might say, isn't this good that he is investing all this money in curing disease all over the world? But it's philanthrocapitalism. That is, it's in his own best interest in maintaining power.
Bill Gates has built one of the biggest charitable foundations in the world that affects the healthcare of billions of people.
At one stage, the Gates Foundation was the second largest funder of the World Health Organization after the US government. He who pays the piper gets to call the tune. And in this case, was Gates actually getting to call the tune at a major United Nations organization?
I remember the time Bill Gates walks to the World Health Assembly, which is the highest, if you like, health cabinet of the world. And I was just stunned with the reception he got. These people, they know about healthcare in their countries. And here's Bill Gates lecturing them. He's received like what he is now, the czar of global health. People almost bow to him.
Bill Gates is a college dropout. He has no medical training. I don't think we could say that Bill Gates is particularly well qualified to have such an influential role over public health.
Bill Gates has seen his personal wealth increase by $41 billion since becoming a philanthropist.
He built this extremely powerful monopolistic company, Microsoft, and then he became almost an equally influential person in the second chapter. That same Bill Gates from Microsoft is now at the Gates Foundation. They aren't two separate men, they are the same man.
This is in the eastern part of Kenya. It's a semi-arid region. The bulk of the population are smallholder farmers. There's a lot of maize being planted in the area.
We have the citrus, we have the beans, passion fruits, indigenous type of mangoes.
The Gates Foundation has spent nearly $6 billion funding agricultural projects across Africa.
As a Kenyan, I would understand the challenges facing my continent. Africa has 330 million smallholder farmers. Many of them have not gone to school. Many of them are elderly. So this creates a conducive environment to perpetuate the agenda of Bill Gates.
Gates has funded a controversial farming modernization scheme that critics say is against the will of many African farmers. Known as Agra, it advocates using fertilizers and genetically modified seeds to boost food production in poor countries.
But it has not even come close to meeting those goals. And what it has done instead, it has increased the ability of foreign agribusiness corporations to access African markets.
Gates supports the sale of seeds and chemicals made by multinational companies, leading to criticism that he's prioritizing corporate interests.
They're actually oppressing the small-scale farmer for the benefit of the big companies. The small-scale farmer should be asked for his opinion.
We are talking about power of food production in the hands of multinational corporations, and to them, the main interest is to make profit and to make money. The Bill Gates Foundation, of course, it's not philanthropy, it's actually business.
But in this glossy corporate video, Bill Gates insists that GM seeds will save Africa, entertaining the crowd with his vision.
And the answer is innovation. 14 years ago, the Gates Foundation funded a group of researchers in Africa to breed drought-tolerant varieties of maize.
The corporations owning the seeds make money by patenting the technology. Farmers must buy the GM seeds every year, or the seeds won't work.
The way that the seeds work is that they become less efficacious after, like, a growing season. People have to kind of be locked into those cycles of buying seeds.
Bill Gates advocates that impoverished farmers buy seeds on credit, despite similar schemes proving catastrophic in countries like India.
They are given, you know, this kind of loan in the form of inputs and seeds. And then they have to repay that loan in cash. This creates a sense of desperation among many farmers who are in this kind of cyclical process of trying to maintain their farm. When you introduce massive amounts of debt on farmers that can't be repaid, it can lead to suicide and other kinds of social issues and breakdowns. Going back to this kind of idea that the Gates Foundation is helping solve poverty, that kind of thing is how you actually deepen poverty.
The Bill Gates Foundation is actually making Africans imagine that they are modernized, but in reality, they are moving closer to the grave.
There are strong parallels between what the Gates Foundation is doing now and neocolonialism. Somehow, a white man from Seattle, Washington, knows more about African agriculture than African farmers themselves.
It always amazes me how arrogant some men can be. And it's particularly true for men of wealth. Bill Gates thinks of himself as the most intelligent, talented person in the world. And he thinks that he can get up to speed on anything. The truth of the matter is, there's a lot that he doesn't know.
Controversy has followed Gates across Africa. His response to the COVID pandemic has led to particular criticism by health insiders.
Bill Gates' heart is in the right place. I think he genuinely wants to solve society's biggest problems. When the pandemic started, all hell broke loose. I knew that if I got COVID, I'd probably die. It was terrifying. The sense of trying to get a vaccine and not being able to get one, I was going crazy. I'm Catherine Choptunji, and I'm the executive director of the African Population and Health Research Center, based in Nairobi, Kenya. The Gates Foundation is one of our top 10 funders. They're a critical player in the region.
Gates was the chief architect of COVAX, a scheme used by 172 countries with ambitious targets to source COVID vaccines for billions of the poorest people on Earth. There was one obvious source.
The University of Oxford, who invented the British vaccine, initially said they wanted it to be patent-free. They believed it should be a vaccine for anybody in the world who was able to make it and able to produce it. There was then a negotiation which Bill Gates' foundation got involved in. And when that negotiation had finished, it turned out that the vaccine knowledge had actually been handed over to AstraZeneca. And they were suddenly in charge of who could buy it, of who could produce it, of who ultimately got it. The Gates Foundation denies that they forced that decision, but it's been reported in much of the press that they did.
Gates supported an exclusive deal between COVAX and pharmaceutical company AstraZeneca.
Bill Gates has personal relationships with the CEOs of big drug and vaccine companies. He was just trying to protect big drug companies.
He does everything to keep the monopoly on knowledge and on the product in the hands of these companies.
Gates has had major investments in pharmaceutical companies. He defends their rights to COVID vaccines in confident media appearances like this.
The thing that's holding things back in this case is not intellectual property. There's not like some idle vaccine factory with regulatory approval that makes magically safe vaccines. You've got to do the trials on these things. I do a regular phone call with the pharmaceutical CEOs to make sure that work is going at full speed.
Bill Gates regularly said, look, we have to depend upon the big pharmaceutical companies because they're the only ones that could actually manufacture these vaccines in bulk. What Bill Gates repeatedly said isn't true. And unfortunately, the fact he said it convinced many people that it was true, because that's an example of the power and influence that he's got.
It transpired that over a billion AstraZeneca vaccines earmarked for COVAX were to be made in just one factory in India.
By what logic would anybody think that one company would provide for the whole of Africa, let alone the rest of developing countries?
COVAX was touted as the solution, not a solution, the solution.
In 2021, COVAX had produced just a fraction of what was promised to the poorest countries on Earth.
It was really scandalous in country after country after country, absolute horror scenes of bodies piling up. The loss of life as a result of the fact that while we here in the West were getting our third and fourth doses, frontline health workers and the most vulnerable people in society in many countries around the world had not been vaccinated. They'd had nothing.
While vaccine distribution later improved, in 2021, COVAX was a failure. Insiders like Catherine Chubutonji are speaking out for the first time, blaming Bill Gates' refusal to support vaccine patent waivers.
That was the worst thing he did in the pandemic. In spite of all the havoc that the pandemic wreaked, people are still intent on maintaining the status quo when it came to power, because that is going to destabilize, I don't know, maybe shareholder value or something. That, yeah, you can have a system where people think that maintaining your economic power is much more important than the lives of billions of people. I don't know. I think for me, it was the worst thing that he could have done.
Bill Gates was in a position more than any other individual or any other institution outside of a government to have pushed things in the right direction. But on the contrary, he pushed it in exactly the wrong direction. And so he deserves a lot of blame because he had a lot of power.
Who elected Gates to be the global health czar? Who gave him this permission to effect or at least constrain the decision-making of domestic national governments? No one gave him that permission. He took it himself.
He hands himself so much power and influence over societies that he doesn't live in, that he doesn't come from, that he is, in effect, having a huge amount of influence over the way that those countries develop.
You have this unelected billionaire in Seattle with his hands on the levers for how we feed poor people, how we grow food, how they access medicine.
And with Gates spending billions on health, poverty, and agriculture, there is a culture of silence across those sectors.
If you irritated or annoyed the Gates Foundation, the money might dry up. Maybe we just need to, in essence, let him do whatever he wants and then not risk currying his displeasure, because what if he tries to silence you or other people?
I've had people ask me to wear a mask and a hat to meetings. I've had people who have said, how do you know you weren't followed? It's a strange thing, I think, for people who see the Gates Foundation as this great humanitarian organization to understand the culture of fear that really engulfs the foundation.
The fear was enough to lead people to be reluctant to speak up. But we did it, many of us, with some fear over our own professional futures.
Catherine Chubutonji is one of the only people in the world who receives Gates' funding, who's willing to criticize him publicly.
Speaking out against the foundation and maybe speaking out, being critical of Bill Gates, of course, it could have repercussions, but I honestly feel liberated. And I feel liberated to speak to power, to speak truth to power. I feel liberated to speak for Africans. I don't set out to speak about the Gates Foundation and their role in enhancing global health inequity. But I turned 50 this year, and I asked myself,
if I don't advocate when I'm 50, when will I advocate? When I'm 75? When I'm 65? If it's not me, then who?
Many people have something to lose. I was not afraid of what would happen if I spoke out. I just decided it was time to actually be willing to talk about the person he really is. I'm 71 years old, and I'm at that stage of my career where I'm not afraid at all.
I don't think it's fair to say that he's a supervillain, but what's happened is we've made him into a kind of superhero. In reality, he is a deeply flawed and maybe even a deeply troubled man. I think it's a mistake to underestimate what he's capable of.